Thank you. I am very honored to be here, not only on behalf of my good colleague, Tom Kailath, but to introduce a good, distinguished colleague and friend. Don Knuth, the Professor Emeritus of the Art of Computer Programming, really needs no introduction. But Don, you're going to get one anyway. My challenge here is to keep the introduction short enough that we actually have time left for the talk, because I could do this properly and fill up the entire time. So I've limited myself to 10 facts about Don, some of which you may not know. In eighth grade, he entered a contest to form as many words possible out of the statement, Ziegler's Giant Bar. The judges had formed a list of 2,500 words. Don's list had 4,500 words on. That won him a television set for his school and candy bars for everyone in his class. As an undergraduate at Case Western, Don was torn between physics versus music. And I'll come back to the music thing. But he got very interested in computing. They had an IBM 650 at that time. He found that the compiler and assembler were not very good, so he rewrote them both. He then switched to math, finished his BS, and was awarded by vote of the faculty a master's degree simultaneously on account of his achievement. Coming back to music, he is a great musician and a great lover of music, a great organist who has his own 16-rank organ built into his home. Fourth, after receiving his PhD at Caltech, Don began work there as an associate professor and began the work that would become his life's true labor, namely the book series, The Art of Computer Programming, in 1962. Originally, it was commissioned as a book on compilers, but Don realized quickly that there was a framework missing that talked about data structures and algorithms, and that he had to first start by developing that framework. So he designed a book with 12 chapters. The book became The Multi-Volume Art of Computer Programming. The plan called for 7 volumes, and in fact, book one lists all 7 volumes. So far, we have 3 volumes and part one of the fourth volume completed, which is amazing. I have to say that there have been several new editions, essentially complete rewrites of several of the books along the way. As Don said at one point, it was a completely, totally new field with no real identity. And for those of us in computer science, while earlier individuals, Turing and Church and others, had laid the foundation for the theory part of computer science algorithms and data structures are at the heart of the field. And there was no framework for those things. So in Don's book, he set the mathematical and scientific basis for that, and computer science became a better discipline because of that. Number five, he initially offered $2.56, hexadecimal double digits for errors. Checks were rarely cashed. When we discovered this and Dave Patterson and I decided to offer money for errors, we had the smarts from Don's experience to open a checking account that you never tried to balance because the checks would never get cashed. Nowadays, you don't actually get a check because bank fraud has become so rampant that you have to now get a certificate from an imaginary bank that Don sends you. Compilers and language translation are critical issues, especially in the early days of computer science. They're a central problem, how to translate from one language to another, be it the assembly language, target language of a machine, or between two other languages. There had been enormous work done on parsing, the process of understanding whether or not a language belonged to a grammar and how it was structured. Much of that work was done by colleagues here at Stanford. Don wrote a famous paper on LR parsing, which, after lots of people had worked on this, completely solved the problem in one fell swoop. Done, game, set, match. The problem was over. The paper is a tour de force and really amazing insights. Number seven, during the revision of volume two, the quality of the typography and the font availability was not up to the standard Don had set. Hot lead type was going away, and he decided to take a small detour that led to the invention of Tech and Metafont, some 5, 6, 7 years detour. But it completely revolutionized those fields, completely, how we typeset, especially how we typeset complex mathematics and how fonts are designed and specified. And if you ever want to hear two incredible lectures, go hear Don's lecture on how tech is conceived and how it works. It is a lecture of brilliance, illustrating in very simple terms what a very complex typesetting process. And I still, one of the great lectures I remember hearing was his lecture on the letter S and how to form the best letter S. But the whole issue of font design has been recreated by the work that Don did on Metafont. Number 8, he's a member of the National Academy of Engineering, the National Academy of Science, the French Academy of Sciences, the Royal Society, winner of the Turing Award, the Kyoto Prize, the National Medal of Science, and dozens of honorary degrees. He is fond of wearing different portions from his regalia of honorary degrees in combined fashion at Stanford commencement ceremonies. But I find this quite appropriate because he's the only person I personally know that has a planet named after them. For the last two, I'm going to add two personal notes. When I came to Stanford to interview for a faculty position, Don Knuth was one of the people that I went and talked to. To say that I was intimidated is an understatement. Here I am talking to a person who even then was thought of as one of the founding fathers of the discipline. Don was never personally intimidating, but I was a little intimidated. But in that interview, I got two wonderful insights from Don that I have used throughout my own life and many times. First of all, I asked him, why CS? He had worked in mathematics, he'd started in physics, he'd been interested in music. Why computer science? And he said, that's my brain operates really well. It's aligned with the way you need your brain to operate in computer science. And when he said that, I realized, well, maybe my brain was really aligned that way too. And this is advice I've passed on to numerous students. If you find that you think well in a discipline, you probably are going to be very good at it. The other thing I asked Don was how he managed to be so prolific. How could he get so much done? He told me, I don't watch TV. And I've taken that advice to heart ever since. Finally, the art of computer programming, which formed the engineering and scientific basis for our discipline. When Dave Patterson and I decided to write our books about computer architecture, we took our direct inspiration from Don. Just as Don had laid a foundation that really underlied computer science, we hoped to do the same thing in computer architecture. And our book is really a tribute to what Don was able to do. From the cloth binding that matches the kind of cloth binding that's on the art of computer programming, to the use of exercise ratings to tell students, you probably should be able to do this easily, and this is very hard. We followed that. To his tremendous way in which he illustrates principles, complex ideas, and breaks them down into chunks that are bite-sized, at least for reasonably capable people. But I want to conclude this little part with just a story which I think is truly unique. At the time Don was rewriting Volume 1, he went back to redevelop Mix and did M-Mix. So he asked for, we had given him a copy of our book and he was reading it just to try to understand what was happening with ideas like caching and pipelining and things like that. It was the third edition. By that time we had probably sold close to 100,000 copies. Professional engineers had used it to design machines at Intel and various other companies. It was in the, you could actually order it from the online catalog if you worked inside Microsoft. We had hundreds and thousands of students, hundreds of instructors had used it. There was one very complicated piece in it that talks about logical equations necessary to issue instructions in complex out-of-order machines. Don found an error in that section that nobody else had found. And that's the kind of insight and incredible individual Don Knuth is. Please join me in welcoming our distinguished colleague, Don Knuth.
Thank you. Right. Well, I can't possibly live up to that. I hope I have a chance to introduce you someday. title of my talk today, Let's Not Dumb Down the History of Computer Science. And I have to start out essentially by saying that this might be the greatest mistake in my life to give this talk today. I'm going to talk about controversial stuff. And the truth is, I actually hate polemics. I go out of my way to avoid arguments whenever possible. And the worst kind of argument is about matters of taste when you know, people should clearly have a... everybody should be free to disagree. And so how can I argue about something where a lot of people can have different ideas and taste? On the other hand, I feel so strongly about this that I just had to vent and say it. So anyway, here goes. And of course, it looks like there are enough people here that some of you might agree with me anyway. Computer people have a word for what I'm going to do. We call it flaming. And I have to tell you in advance that I'm 76 years old now, and therefore, I'm no doubt getting grumpier every minute. Now, my talk is going to be non-standard also in another way. I'm talking about, you know, there's history in the title, but I'm not going to tell you about the history of computer science. I'm not going to tell you about what cool ideas are or who invented them or what. Instead of talking about the history, I'm talking about historians of computer science. I'm talking about historiography. So this is, you know, meta history. I'm going to try to explain why I personally love to read works on history and why I continue to spend considerable time reading historical works and why I'm profoundly disturbed by recent trends in the things that I've been reading. So now, in order to get you all into a historical mood, you can see that I'm using old-fashioned technology here. I'm purposely using an overhead projector instead of a computer. So you also get, you know, I'm not going back to punch cards, but it's, so. All right. Anyway, I want to start out upbeat, so the first thing I want to do is give a testimonial for the historians who are doing it right. Why do I personally, as a scientist, get a lot out of reading history of science? So let me count the ways. First of all, and this is really number one for sure, to understand the process of discovery. Now, some people would call it invention. Instead of discovery, I don't want to get into that kind of a debate. But what I mean is, I want to know not so much what was discovered, but how it was discovered. The best thing for me is to read primary sources, if possible, to find the words of somebody who discovered something as they were discovering it, the way they described it at the time, the original words. And the more examples of this that I see about how somebody discovered something, the more likely I'll be able to discover something tomorrow. You know, it helps my own research all the time in order to have more and more case studies of how people discovered things. Number two is a little harder to read, but I'll read it to you. Understanding the process of failure. This is almost equally important in a way. We learn a good deal from errors, not only our own errors, but also just to seeing historical errors as well as successes. I have to learn not to be afraid of making mistakes, and then how to recover from mistakes and use them for guidance. Another part of this, which is not often mentioned, is that when we see that some of the greatest minds of all time are unable to grasp things that seem obvious to us today, this gives us a better way to calibrate the intrinsic difficulty of ideas. For example, let's take Leibniz, for example. He spent a lot of his time trying to do combinatorics. And most of what he did when he was working on combinatorics was not only very underwhelming, but it was totally wrong. And so I can be a much better teacher and writer if I can understand why it is that Leibniz didn't get it. Okay. Number three, celebrating the contributions of many cultures. It's important to understand that there are many, many different ways of thinking, also that particular concepts can be perceived from many, many different points of view. For example, Fibonacci numbers were discovered a few hundred years before in India, long before the time of Fibonacci. Catalan numbers were discovered in China before, 100 years before time of Catalan. Each discovery added to the other, though, in different parts of the world, because they had different approaches or they had different motivations. And so lots and lots of illiterate people from around the world have discovered wonderful patterns, and I can enjoy the, I can share with them the evident joy that they had when they found these patterns. So I love that aspect as well. Number four, telling stories is really the best way to teach to explain something. One of my main goals throughout my life has been as a teacher and writer, and so I want to reach other people and pass along the ideas that excite me. What's the best way to teach them? And human beings over the centuries have sort of evolved to communicate with each other best by telling stories to each other. And so history gives us the stories that we much easier to understand something if you have some thread that it belongs to and that lodges in your brain much better if you have the story to go with it. One of the motivations in this respect is to give credit where credit is due. For example, Fibonacci gets credit, but also so does Narayana in India. But that's not the main thing about these stories. The main thing I try to understand is that the history of every field I've looked at is really not so much the story of great milestones and sort of what are the top 10 discoveries in this area, but instead the real story is that many, many separate individuals are working in collaboration, and together they're building a magnificent edifice by a series of small steps. I mean, you think of the Great Wall of China, and it had lots and lots of stones went into that wall, and that's the way there's a great wall of computer science and so on happening. So that's a great story. Number five, learning how to cope with life. Besides understanding technical details about scientific things, of course, I also want to see how other scientists grew up, how they made friends, how they maybe made some enemies, how do they manage their time, did they like music, what did they do for hobbies. Who do they get mentorship from? Who do they mentor? And what service do they do to the community? All these things. So science is a major part of my life, but it's less than half. Balance is important, and so I like to. And number six, out of six here is become more familiar with the world, and this is just in general, to know how science fits in with overall history of mankind. What was life like for people on different continents in different epochs of time? It seems to me that the main difference between human beings and animals is that people like us learn from history. We have a sense of history, and so we know what happened in past times much more than Tom's dog did, for example. Okay, so I'm grateful to historians, especially historians of mathematics, because of the things that they do that better than anybody else. And the first thing I'm really thankful for is that they can make source materials accessible. This means, I say, I like to see the words of the originators, what they're doing. A lot of times, or most of the time, if you go back in history, it's not in English. And so I got to have, somebody has to do a good job of translating into something that, I can learn maybe German and French and Russian, but I don't have time to learn Hungarian, and Japanese and all these other languages, but not to mention Indian languages, which are about 100 of them. Historians can bring that, make it available to scientists like me. Also, notational barriers. The people who didn't only use different words, but they use different symbols, and it's a trick to learn we can sort of put ourselves into the mind of these inventors, even though they were using different symbols, but somehow not being totally unable to understand because the symbols are so different from ours. So historians can do this great. Then scouting out archival documents. Now here, there's a great talent for finding letters, finding unpublished papers, other archives, the civil records, medical records, financial records, minutes of meetings, all kinds of scraps of information exist somewhere in the world, and historians have been really good at smoking these things out. And then linking things together. Also, they know a lot about what else is going on at the same time in previous times, and so a good historian can do this. The thing that I don't like particularly, if the whole paper is just analysis of trends, what I like to see after they smoke this out, I still like to see source materials. I like to see, exact words. What did somebody say to somebody in this letter, instead of just an overall thing? The things that historians probably work hardest on in order to analyze these trends are the things that are of least interest to me. But I love the ability to bring these other source materials up front. Okay, so this is the good news. Now I have to turn to the bad news. And the good news came mostly from historians of mathematics, and the bad news is going to come from the history of computer science. Here's what sort of did it for me. A shock. 5 years ago, I was reading this paper. You can see the title of History of the History of Software. This paper was actually written 7 years ago, published then, but I'm a little slow reading the literature. So anyway, here one day I came across this article, and I thought, oh, good, it's by Martin Campbell Kelly. I've always liked him. I liked his work. He's kind of the leading historian of computer science. He didn't write this paper for people like me. He wrote it for historians, and it got published later because somebody said, you know, historians liked it, and so they said, okay, we'll publish this in the journal IEEE Annals of History of Computing. So anyway, this gives me some insight as to what historians say when they're talking to historians instead of when they're talking to you know, people like me. All right, so that was the shock. Because the main thing that, sort of the centerpiece of this article is a table that he gave. I don't expect you to be able to read this, but I just want to show you the table. It appears on two pages. Can you sort of see? He takes excerpts from up to three papers from each year and sort of mentions some of the key articles that were written about history of computer science, or history of software, in this case, actually, in that year. And then the point is he classified these papers into four types. He had type T, which is technical. He had type S, which stands for supply side. It means industries, the study of industrial things, economics. Type A was applications, what people have actually done with the software. And then type I was stories of institutions, social and political aspects. So anyway, we start out and 1967, we have one paper called the type T. 69, he has three papers, all type T, and so on. T, and so on. Now we get down to 2004 at the end, and you see what it is. IISISISISAAII. So you see there's been a difference in the way people wrote history of computer science. And how does he describe that difference in his paper? Here in the left column, he says, this table shows how the subject matter has broadened. In the 1960s and 70s, people wrote about technology, code, software engineering practices. Starting in the 80s, people began to write about software economic activity and so on. Then he gets on and he says, over time, software history has evolved from narrow technical studies through supply-side economic studies to broad studies of application. Okay, and the thing is, he thinks that's good. And so it really, you know, I grant that it's broad, but it's also extremely shallow. I mean, it's completely non-technical, so I have to admit that when I was reading this page, I broke down and started to cry. I finished reading it only with great difficulty because tears had made my glasses wet. So I immediately dashed off a letter. Actually, my glasses are still wet when I wrote this letter. I'll read you part of it now because I got time of ending. So, dear Martin, I had always greatly admired your writing about CS history until today when I came across your recent article, The History of Squared Software. Don't laugh. I'm writing this in tears. You have to understand. Okay. Alas, I must confess that by the time I got to the last three or four pages, I was so upset I could barely see straight. I didn't want to tell him about the tears, but you know. I had to force myself to read slowly, not believing you had succumbed to the alarming to me trend and fads of the moment about how history, quote, ought to be, unquote, written. Do you not see any blind spots in your outlook when your table one shows 68% class T articles in the first 20 years and 0% class T in the last 5 years? And then you say the table shows how the subject matter has broadened. It has not broadened, it has totally shifted. All we get nowadays is dumbed down. Okay, so next. So then I say, thank goodness historians of mathematics have not what is it, totally, entirely abandoned writing articles that contain formulas or explain scientific ideas, rather than just sticking to things like the strategies a mathematician has used to, in order to get into an academy or something. Now, I'm not sure, I'm sure that business historians, business histories are as difficult to write as technical histories, and they are no doubt also as valuable to businessmen as technical histories are valuable to technicians. But you seem to be celebrating the fact that nobody writes technical CS history at all anymore. When you speak of obvious holes, you are thinking of obvious holes in business history, and you mentioned the video game industry, for example. But now, to me, okay, there's lots of great papers that ought to be written about video game. The people who write these video games have invented, marvelous breakthrough in techniques about how to render scenes, how to pack data in a small space, how to do lots of things in parallel, how to coordinate thousands of online users. All of these are brilliant ideas that make great stories. But the lack of anything even close to describing these techniques and how they were discovered and under what constraints they were discovered seems to be a much more obvious hole, but you show no indication even to admit its existence and much less to suggest plugging it. So, okay, so anyway, I wrote this letter, and I think I'm going to read you a little more of his article. Just to show you, again, what I was complaining about. So at the very beginning of his article, he says, Martin says, I've used the word technical several times. Up to the late 70s, software history is almost exclusively technical. My dissertation, his PhD work under Brian Randall at Newcastle, I managed to locate most of the system programs developed for the first three operational British computers. Cambridge EDSAC, the Manchester Mark I, the National Physical Lab Pilot ACE. Studying these programs and their text was utterly absorbing. Absolutely. He loved it at that time. He could see why it was beautiful. And I also interviewed several of the pioneers of these early systems. They were in their 50s, 60s. I studied all of the derivative machines up to 55. In other words, he was doing the kind of history that I came to admire him for. So then he gets to the second page, and remember, he's talking to historians, and he says, by the time in 1976 came along, at the time when he was starting to think about this so-called broader picture, he didn't see how that was concrete the way subroutine linkage was achieved on the EDSAC or how you got an index register in the hardware of a machine. So then he says, well, this biographical mea culpa is not intended as an exercise in humility. He's apologizing. He's saying, I'm guilty of writing this technical history. He said, the people who wrote software, you have to understand, I was just a young man. I was making my foolish, with 20/20 hindsight, what they and we wrote books wrote looks constrained, excessively technical, lacking in breadth of vision. Okay, so here he's apologizing for what I always had admired. Then we get later on in the article, he gives an example of what he should have done. And it turns out that he wrote a book that came out in 2003. It's called Airline Reservation, From Airline Reservations to Sonic the Hedgehog. And then and there's a guy named Mr. Perkins, Harold Perkins, who gave a kind of a poison review in the Times Literary Supplement. And I think Martin was wounded by this. But anyway, here's what the reviewer said. Campbell Kelly is a master of technical detail and the alphabet soup of acronyms. But like most specialists in an arcane activity, he has tunnel vision and provides little social context. This man, Perkins, by the way, I guess is a social historian. Now, So he does internalist history rather like old-fashioned art history or history of science, full of innovators and heroes driven by creative opportunism. The impact of the computer industry on society, on the way people live and communicate, is largely left to the reader's imagination. Actually, this book doesn't really get much into technical details either. I mean, it's still not that much depth. Anyway, even the state and military applications are touched on rather than explained. The computer and its software nervous system brought a revolution in human development as significant as the steam engine, the automobile, or the airplane, and even more effective in shrinking the planet. This technically expert book is rather like old railway history written by railway buffs who know the number of wheels and the horsepower, the names of the engineers and the companies, but they take for granted how railroads changed the world. Okay, so of course, I mean, do I want to buy a book that tells me that, hey, gosh, computers have changed the world? You know, what else is new? I mean, what, why don't you tell me something interesting, you know? It's nice to know that people like Mr. Perkins are starting to get it, that there's something interesting going on, but it's obvious to me that he just didn't have a clue what this book was about, and he has his dignity, so he wants to show that he can do it better, even though he doesn't know anything about the field, by just saying, well, it's just like people who say, I never was very good at mathematics. It must be that mathematics isn't important. You know, I got through. So back to my letter. During the past 20 years, histories and expositions of mathematics for general readers have gotten dramatically better, while the analogous histories and expositions of computer science have gone downhill. With your table one, you could have generated a wake-up call, but instead, you seem to be a Pied Piper for continuing these dismal trends. You have clearly lost faith in the notion that computer science is actually scientific, as well as being also coincidentally related to economics and defense and so on. Yet I myself still cling to that old-fashioned belief. Indeed, if it were true that computer science were no longer a rich science with deep ideas, I could finish the art of computer programming in no time. but it appears that I still have 20 years of work ahead. That was 5 years ago, and I have 25 years of work ahead now. Okay, so. You kindly state that it was okay and even fine for narrow-minded people like me to attempt to write history, even though we have no training as historians, since there is a shortage of historians. Fair enough. But now you are encouraging professional historians to address only the masses of readers like Mr. Harold Perkins and to ignore the scientists who are going to make the thing live up for a few more years. Okay. So I guess I do have the... Another page to show you here. I talk about the 2% of the population who will spend their lives actually writing software. Here I'm talking about John Hennessy and others like us who belong to this mindset that happens to correlate with computer science. So this, you say, is holistic, integrative. I view it as lightweight, mildly interesting, a chance to be witty and win some arguments, so that another witty historian can challenge you and publish more lightweight stuff. That's fine for employment of historians, but it's pretty much a waste of time for a reader who wants to know how to do hard science. The few papers that I've written myself that have a historical component were among the most difficult I've ever done in my life, and I greatly admire the historians who do it properly. In mathematics, I've just purchased superb source books by Jackie Steddall and Elizabeth Robeson, Victor Katz, and so on. I think Stephen Levy's books on hackers and artificial life are wonderful. I hope you will come back to technicalities that displease Mr. Perkins once in a while, because you are one of the few who were able to handle them well. there are millions of lines of brilliant code in existence, and so on and so on. Okay, so Martin replied to me, and I soon learned, and then talking with other colleagues, that well. Okay. By the way, I also met him a few months later at a history meeting in England, and we talked for several hours. But neither of us could get the other one to agree. He keep insisting that he does want his students to write no more books of type T and no more papers of type T. Going back to my earlier slide, where I listed all the ways that why I love history. He's saying number 1, 2, and 3, and 4 aren't important. Only numbers 5 and 6 are of value. Okay. Now, anyway, I soon found out that historians of science have been debating this among themselves for a long time, and they don't call it type T versus something else. They talk about internal history versus external history. So for them, internal history is written by and for people who are knowledgeable about some discipline, and the external histories are written for the masses. Internal histories, these type T, have basically come into disrepute, except, I'm glad to say, with respect to mathematics. This is where Martin says, you know, these type T things have a limited value. But, well, everything has a limited value. Have you ever read something that had unlimited value? I mean, what the heck? Okay. So for example, this has really infected all of history of science. The main journal in history of science is ECIS, ISIS, founded long, long ago. And at the time that I did this, I went and I at the library and I looked up ECIS from 50 years ago, and then I compared it with ECIS from 2008, and there was a sea change that had gone on. If you look in 1958. The articles actually went into a lot of technical details in whatever it was, chemistry, biology. But now we go to 2008, it was almost always about strategies, funding, something like this. Here's an example from 2008, the review of a book called Beyond Artificial Intelligence. And the reviewer says, "History of science awaits a comprehensive history of the decision scientists, in which artificial intelligence is an important actor, but which also include cybernetics, information theory, management science, and operation research. For the time being, we will have to make what we can of the limited perspective provided by practitioners' accounts, such as Beyond AI." Okay, so now, I don't know, I leave it as an exercise why on earth anybody would really want to combine cybernetics, information theory, management science, operation research, and artificial intelligence into a single book. That's because of my cramped perspective. Now, how has mathematics managed to escape this so far? And I suppose it's because historians of math have always faced the fact that they won't be able to please everybody. Historians of other sciences have the delusion that actually, you know, an ordinary person can understand physics. Or at least they pretend it. Last weekend I read an obituary of a distinguished mathematical historian, Christoph Scriba, who died last July. Scriba was probably the leading expert on John Wallis, a 17th century mathematician who was, I think there's no doubt that he was the closest to becoming a computer scientist of anybody in the 17th century. If you learn more about John Wallis, you see that he sort of speaks our language in those days. So Scriba was a disciple of Joseph Huffman, Leibniz scholar. And in 1971, Scriba wrote an essay dedicated to Huffman about the Trends in the History of Mathematics in the Mirror of Time. And so he's considering whether or not history of mathematics should shift over to be more of a social history. So anyway, the obituary says that while recognizing the value of social history and the history of ideas, Scriba remained largely wedded to the approach he had inherited from his academic mentors. Thank God. Now, Scriba did write that he often had trouble making his work comprehensible to uninitiated, but he also complained that a lot of mathematicians who could understand it couldn't care less about what he wrote. But that's another problem. That's shame on us for not appreciating science the way we should. Now, there was one thing that Martin Campbell Kelly and I definitely agreed on, and that is it would really be desirable if there were hundreds of papers written now by computer scientists about computer science. It seems that actually specialists like me are not writing the kind of papers that would fill the gaps, and we're somehow assuming that the historians of mathematics should all of a sudden learn how to do this, learn the computer science instead of just learning how to scout through archives. And so so Martin says at least he wants professional historians to have some data that they can clean up from these misguided people like we are, who do the technical stuff. So he mused, why is it that there aren't almost no papers being written by his computer scientists now? He says that probably it's peer pressure that the papers on history don't seem to get any points. In Britain, they have something notorious called British Research Assessment Exercise, which is used to decide about salaries and promotions. And somebody writes a history paper, probably gets no points in that, and so nobody writes it. In America, I really don't see support for such papers either. So I think that's something that computer scientists ought to, even though it's hard to write these historical papers, we should face the fact, and even though there's no conference on it or something, that we can get it into the okay now. So I want to end with a high note again, and what I hope a tantalizing wish list about what we could do. What do I think is really the best way to write history? And I've always tried to combine breadth and depth, not just shallow and broad, and not just deep and little of both. Somebody made a wonderful definition of a liberal education once. It said that you know something about everything, and you know everything about something. So you got to have the breadth. You got to understand context and stuff. But then in order to really understand, you got to zoom in one or two places. And just look at that as an example from which people have something to hang on to, I use this for example. I wrote a book called 316, where I try to say that the Bible is a really complicated subject, but we can learn a lot more about it if we zoom in to 50 sort of randomly chosen parts and see what people have said about those parts over the years. So I like this idea of breadth plus depth. And now I want to mention just some of the, scratch the tip of the iceberg on some of the many papers that are waiting to be written. concepts of operating systems. You know, I have at home, Edgar Dykstra sent me the source code for the operating system that he wrote in 1965. Nobody has had looked at that. You want to see exactly what kind of code was written in those days. Concepts of databases, the same thing. Early computer programs were filled with ideas that have not ever been really analyzed and set in context. Rendering techniques for motion pictures, or your video games, all these things. So many great ideas are being used at Pixar and all over. We don't want to just see the movies. Computers, people, you can make a story that you can explain to ordinary people and zoom in and show some of the things that go beyond the way you the effects that you see on the screen. You don't just have to see the cool workspaces that these people work in. You can also see the algorithms they're using. I got lots of software that I collected over the years, and in the early 60s there were really really interesting programs written for compilers at Burroughs Corporation group, another group at Computer Sciences Corporation, working especially the one they did for Lark at Livermore, there was a brilliant guy, never published anything except you can read his source code. He was at Digitech Corporation, had completely different ideas for software development that deserve to be resurrected today, I think. Then Computer History Museum has Bill Atkinson's source code released by Apple for Mac Paint and Mac Draw. Really brilliant programs. Beautifully organized, structured, and a treat for anybody to read, and so on and on and on. There's so many wonderful source codes that are completely untouched, and so if we technicians can explain these, then maybe some historians will come along and add the breadth that we lack. So that's my message today. Thank you very much for listening.